We're here today with Professor Janine Wedel from George Mason University, the School of Public Policy. And Janine is a grantee of ours for a very interesting project called Two Key Financial Institutions, a Study of Real Linkages and Policy Influence. She's just getting started on this. It's mainly about the Basel Committee on Banking Supervision and the International Swaps and Derivatives Association. But what's interesting to me about you, Janine, is you're an anthropologist. So you're taking an anthropological approach to understanding how these major international financial institutions work. Help me understand that. I'm just an ordinary economist.
Well, most economists are ordinary economists. So these are two financial institutions about which actually quite little is known, and yet they're extremely important. I mean, they've made or helped to shape major decisions that certainly some would argue helped lead to the financial crisis, especially the ISDA.
Well, the Basel Committee is the one that creates the capital requirements,
exactly.
The Basel 1, 2, and
right.
Now 3, and it is essentially a talking shop of central bankers,
exactly.
I guess you would say, and ISDA is a private operation
right,
of
right.
dealers, security dealers and derivative dealers who are making up the rules that bind them all in a private sort of way.
Right.
But how does an anthropological approach?
There are really two areas, and one is looking at the institutions and the informal practices and the networks. So how things actually are done, how people organize themselves into networks. I'll do as much field work as I can, talking with people. I am somehow able to get myself invited many times to informal discussions. So lots of off-record interviewing, mm-hmm. Hanging out, and like I said, I'll try to understand something about the networks and the institutional makeup, but then on the other hand, really pay attention to how people talk and what they say, what is the language in which they think, and then one tries to link those two things up.
That sounds really, yeah. really interesting. Now, you were mentioning that your book before this was sort of the anthropology of public policy,
mm-hmm.
But I'm just looking at your CV mm-hmm. here, and you began life at a liberal arts college in
yes.
Kansas,
yes.
doing a major called History and the Social Sciences.
Right.
How did that lead to anthropology, or was that anthropology?
So I took economics and, of course, history and sociology and maybe a course in tour in anthropology. And then I got very interested in Eastern Europe. This was under communism. Of course, this was the 70s, late 70s, when I finished college and began graduate school. I studied in Germany. Another major of mine was German. And that I took a trip in the late 70s to Poland, and that led to many years of field work in Poland.
So
in
that
the
was
1980s.
Still anthropology.
That was very much anthropology.
Anthropology of Polish.
My dissertation was really about informal economy in Poland. How do people do? And get things in the economy, in the bureaucracy, when you can't walk into a government office and get a passport to go abroad, or you can't walk into a store and buy something as simple as butter or shoes.
Mm-hmm.
So what are the networks according to which, what are the mindsets in which people then get what they need in order to survive and sometimes to thrive?
Mm-hmm.
And that led to my dissertation and my first book on called The Private Poland. So it was very much an anthropological approach.
But Poland under communism.
Poland under communism. This is still the 1980s.
Mm.
And then in the late 80s, I was again back in Poland under Fulbright fellowships and teaching this time. And this is, of course, when the era of glasnost emanating from Mikhail Gorbachev in the Soviet Union. So I began to see things under communism in Poland that had never before happened. I was studying the organizations, the informal, underground, really, subterranean organizations that people developed, and all of a sudden these organizations were able to declare themselves. Now, what on earth did that have to do with anything that was important? Well, if you wanted to understand then who ran Poland in the next sort of 20 years, these informal groups from way back in the 70s and the 80s had a lot to do with the kinds of
the
political
origin.
Yes, formations, and who was important, and where did that influence come from? It didn't just all of a sudden appear. What I learned actually starting in the early 90s, when I was still based in Eastern Europe trying to understand foreign aid, what I began to see there was an international set of transnational fixers, if you will, brokers. And there were a couple of prominent economists that I actually followed. He was actually one of the people who intrigued me. And what intrigued me about him was the way in which he took on multiple roles in multiple venues with multiple sponsors. And none of that was ever fully disclosed. And so it was the model of this sort of power broker. He was at the forefront of that model. And I don't mean to single him out. He just was
a model.
He was an archetype. Mm-hmm. Eastern Europe under transition, what happens when you have a communist state authoritarian state that collapses, the authoritarian structures collapse, what happens is that the people, the brokers who were well positioned in that state then try to manage the vacuum. Mm-hmm. And so what I charted was how did these people help shape the political economy mm-hmm. that developed, and what were the kinds of public-private interfaces and arrangements and combinations that emerged, and many of those arrangements one now sees very very clearly in a lighter form in the United States. If you think of the bailouts, for instance, the Washington Wall Street financial bailout a few years ago, that was a very small set of people that were making the decisions, and the organizing principle was not who's in government, mm-hmm. right? It was who was in this little circle.
Mm-hmm. This is all incredibly fascinating. I could talk to you for hours about this. I want to just leave you by saying that at INET, economic thinking is thinking about the economy. And it definitely sounds to me like you've been thinking about the economy basically from day one. But in a way that is different from the way other economists do. But at INET, you're an economist.
Uh-huh.
Welcome to the stable of INET economists, Janine.
Thank you.
If you'll
Thank
have
you.
us.
Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you. I'm honored.